everybody, and welcome to Powerful Stuff. You guys have guessed it. We have some powerful stuff here for you today, and I've really been enjoying these interactive ones that we've been doing together. I feel like we're processing things together, we're expanding together, we're growing together. So let's have that journey continue. So as many of you might know or might not know, I am outside of powerful stuff or within powerful stuff. I'm a leadership coach. And one of the things that I do is I have a group coaching program for women called The Upgrade. And it's a 12-week transformational program. And we are in week 4 right now, which is the shadow week. And so I want to take you guys through shadow work together. We're going to do it together. We're going to bring our shadows to the light today. And I just led this for my women this week. It was super powerful. And I thought, you know what? I should probably do it myself right now. And maybe the powerful stuff leaders and listeners, because you all are leaders listening. I thought we could all do it together. How does that sound? So if you're not familiar with shadow work or your shadow side, or even if you are, I'll just give my little explanation of it, my little explanation, if you will. So shadow work is this idea of bringing things that we deem unsavory about ourselves to the light, and the things that we kind of always self-sabotage on, or always say like, why does this always happen to me? Or this always happens, you know, things that we might be ashamed about, things that we procrastinate, basically the things about ourselves that we try to sweep under the rug. It's kind of like what our shadow work is. And it would be remiss of me not to mention Carl Jung as I'm talking about it. He has this famous quote, "Until we make the subconscious conscious, it will rule our lives and we will call it fate." Wow. Let's let that land for a second. And what that essentially means is, you know, shadow work, like if we kind of have this cognitive dissonance or sweep parts of ourselves under the rug and parts of ourselves are feeling unseen or unrecognized, they'll keep coming up. They'll keep coming up until we bring them to the light, right? It's the idea of pulling that monster out from under the bed and being like, oh, it's not as scary as I thought. This monster is not as big. But when that monster is looming under the bed, you're not sure how big it is. It can seem like the hugest thing in the world. And then you kind of operate from this place of fear, or kind of like long-term ignorance is bliss, but it's not, you know, instead of just pulling that sheet up, seeing that monster, giving it some light, giving it some love, and then having it dissipate. Doesn't that sound wonderful? So another person I would be remiss to mention in this episode is Carolyn Elliott. So she wrote one of my all-time favorite books called Existential Kink. And existential kink is like a really fun way of playing with our shadow work. Like, it doesn't have to be so serious. So as per the Carl Jung quote, Carolyn Elliott is saying, like, if stuff keeps happening to us, or we keep being like, why me? Or why do I always find myself in this situation, or with these type of business partners, or in these type of romantic situations, or why does chaos always follow me? She's saying it's because some part of us likes it. Some part of us feels safe in it. And even if it's not what our intellectual self wants, it's what some part of us feels safe in, because it's consistent, because it's familiar. So some part of us keeps replicating and reinforcing that belief that says like, see, I told you I'm not enough. See, I told you I'm not capable. See, I told you so. And so in this analogy, I always like to tell the women in The Upgrade, it's like imagining we have, you know, our inner child, but like imagine having inner child twins. And one is, you know, the inner child that always gets the gold stars that we're like, you know, is always achieving. And we're like, see, this is the inner child that I love. And then one is the shadow inner child that feels ashamed, or that's working through things. And the more we try to sweep it under the rug or ignore it, as you can imagine with the kid, if you were doing that, the kid would grow more and more resentful and might end up throwing temper tantrums to try to get your attention. And so that's kind of what our shadow side is. So not to classify our shadow side as some like raging bitch that we hate, but rather to see it as like a scared inner child part of us that's just acting up and being a little tender with it, being like, okay, I see you. I see you acting up. What are you scared about? What do you need? And just kind of slowing down that conversation with that part of ourself, and giving that part of ourself compassion and love. And it doesn't mean that by giving it compassion and love, we're, you know, accepting it, right? If a child was crying for candy, it's not like you're going to be like, okay, here's like a gallon of candy. You might be like, oh, that makes sense. Like, I get that you're sad. It's okay. You can cry, you know? So you're accepting it. You're holding space for it, but you're not necessarily like condoning it, you know? So I just like to make that distinction. Shadow work can be this hefty concept, but the TLDR, the too long don't read, as they say in the corporate world, is just enjoying getting to know that part of yourself, bringing love to it, bringing awareness to it, asking it what it needs to feel seen. Because as the other famous saying goes, what we resist persists. And the more we resist it, the more we create this impasse of energy. And the more that energy is stuck, the more that will remain stuck. And that will keep repeating these situations that we say we don't want. So when we bring acceptance to it by saying, it's okay, this happened, it's okay, what do you need, from that place of acceptance, we can then make an empowered choice. Wow. Okay, so what we're going to do today for our shadow work, this is what we did in the upgrade, is we're first going to just think of like part of our shadow side that's maybe keeping us from something that we want to do or say we want to do. And it's keeping us from this thing because it probably has a fear for some reason. There's some unseen fear. So what we're going to start by doing is what Carolyn Elliott in Existential Kink calls a deepest fear inventory. So that's when you're just going to list out all of the deepest fears around this thing. Even if they seem comical, I want you to laugh by the time you're at the end of this list of like, oh my gosh, that fear is kind of unfounded, kind of crazy. But you know what? Part of me felt it and that's valid and I'm bringing it to light now. So we're just going to get all those deepest fears out. So I'm going to go first about my shadow side and how it was acting up today. And then as always, you'll pause the recording, do it for yourself, and we'll reconvene. Okay. So for my deepest fear inventory, for my shadow side this week, I feel like there's a big change on the horizon and something that would help me kind of compound the different things that I'm doing. That would help streamline kind of like my personal brand and hopefully catapult it in a big way. And I've been finding myself procrastinating and resisting it, making a little bit of excuses, getting hung up on, you know, annoying things that other people did so I can focus on that instead of doing my own work, right? Or getting on saying I don't have a lot of time and then getting on Instagram and scrolling and finding things to feel triggered by that other people are doing or compare myself to, things that I know that I'm not going to feel good about. Okay, so that's Meredith's shadow side. Some part of her is feeling afraid of being seen. She's feeling afraid of taking that leap, of making that shift. So I'm going to list out the deepest fears and you're going to see me. I'm going to like have each fear build on each other so it eventually goes to rock bottom. So here's my deepest fear inventory around that. Okay. Shaking it out. Okay, my deepest fear is that I will make the wrong decision and the other things that I've worked so hard for will come to naught. My fear is that I'll be labeled as a failure again. My fear is that I'll be even more seen, which means I'm even more susceptible to scrutiny, and I'm an empath. And if I get scrutiny, that would destroy me, it would silence me. And if it silences me, then I'll feel like even more resentful of all of my wasted potential. And if I feel even more resentful of all my wasted potential, I'll just sit feeling angry. And if I sit feeling angry, then I'm like not in alignment with the coach that I say I am. And I'll lose my clients and then I'll lose my coaching practice. And then I'll have to find something else as a job. And then I'll have to make substantial cuts in my lifestyle because I've just kind of like everything is a dumpster fire and everything is a dumpster fire. And then I'll feel ashamed and my friends won't want to be friends with me anymore because it won't be inspiring to them. My husband is going to be like really disappointed in me and it's going to affect our relationship. Maybe he's even like, this isn't the person I married. And who knows, maybe he leaves me. Whoo. Okay. That was the deepest fear inventory, guys. Feels good to just get it out. You can see how I really dialed that up to like 200%. And I want you to note that these aren't actually fears that will happen. They're just like those little crazy thoughts in the back of our head. So you got to hear mine. I want to hear yours. Go ahead and pause the recording. Write out your deepest fears. Let your shadow side talk. Be like, you have the megaphone now. I'm just going to write, stream of consciousness. And once you think you've gotten every fear out, write like three more extra ridiculous fears. Okay, go. Wow. Welcome back. How does that feel? Do you feel hopefully like lighter, or like, I hope you had a good laugh about your fear and how crazy our fears can be when we just let them go unchecked, running rampant, chat in the back of our head. Okay, guys. So don't worry. We're not just going to sit in those fears, though it felt good to get them out, right? It's like an emotional colonic. And what we're going to do now is a deepest possibility on the other side of those fears. So what is the deepest possibility if you don't let those fears win and you actually take action on this thing? So again, I'll go first. My deepest possibility is that this was the right decision and it frees up so much time and I actually have more time to do what I love versus these menial tasks. My deepest possibility is that something shifts inside of me and I wake up feeling even more energized to get out of bed every day. My deepest possibility is that this shift actually contributes to my personal brand and my coaching practice, and I actually end up getting even more aligned clients and spend even more time doing what I love. My deepest possibility is that it re-enlivens my relationship with my husband. We both feel so proud and celebratory of each other. He's like even more proud of me because he's always been my number one cheerleader. Deepest possibility is that the shift connects me to some even more amazing, inspired people, and I continue to grow in that way. My deepest possibility is that this shift unlocks a huge creativity for me and powerful stuff reaches hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people. My deepest possibility is that I create an even more aligned life, just executing in my zone of genius while impacting millions. Wow. I don't know about you guys, but I definitely want to operate on the deepest possibility side than my deepest fear. So go ahead and do your deepest possibility too, and let your imagination run wild. Get as specific with those possibilities that could happen as you can, and go. Okay, now just look at those two lists, the deepest fear and the deepest possibility, and ask yourself, like, which do you want to be operating from? Which do you want to let lead? And you know what? The fact of the matter is, guys, our fears never go away, but the difference is, and I've heard other people say this a lot too, it's that it's no longer in the driver's seat. It's no longer the thing driving us. And so what you want to have happen is you just kindly tell your fears, okay, so you're in the driver's seat. I'm going to move you to the passenger seat, buckle up, and the possibilities are going to drive, okay? Now, if you want to tell me something, you can, and I love you, and it's not going to influence where this car is going. So in that way, you're still letting your fear or that like little inner child part of you that's a little scared say something, and it's important to let them say something because then you can reassure them. You can reassure them that you've got them and that helps build trust. That helps build trust between you and them. So you're not squashing them and say, go away, fear. I fixed you on powerful stuff or whatever. Or I read Existential Kink and now my fears are gone. It's not a silver bullet like that. It's a continued dialogue. It's a continued, okay, I see you coming up. I love you. And you're going to be in the passenger seat. And as Carolyn Elliott says, fear is excitement without the breath, meaning that the fear sometimes means that it's something that you should lean into. But if we just have the fear and we don't pause and we don't have that dialogue with it, then we let it paralyze us versus noticing the fear and okay, talking to it. What does it need to be reassured? Assuaging it, coming to that place of acceptance. And then what is my new choice that brings me to the possibility? Does that make sense? Let me know in the show notes or in the Instagram comments. Email me. Let me know. I want to know. Okay. So after we do this, you're going to do this other part on your own. Once I got all the good sound equipment and mixing setups, we would dance together. But for now, I'm just going to tell you what to do and you can do it on your own time and really let yourself loose with it. So I want you to pause the recording or do this after you listen to the rest of the recording. And I want you to put on like a sexy angry song. I like Sirens by Monolink because in it, he's like, I want to be turned into the darkness that beats in you. And it's like, let your shadow side lead. Whatever you need to do to feel comfortable. It might feel a little awkward at first. Not going to lie to you. I want you to like get in your room, blast this music, close your eyes, and allow your shadow side to come out like some sexy villain vixen, you know, like in your like Catwoman suit or whatever it might be. And just like let your shadow side lead, let your movements be primal. Like imagine that you're pulling this black tar out of your body and like throwing it to the earth, you know? Like who is that sexy, dark alter ego villain, like crawling on the floor, like growling, maybe even making some primal sounds or screaming into a pillow, just letting your shadow side out, letting your shadow side fully express. And guys, this part is so important because it allows your shadow side to just fully feel seen and all that angst and rage and whatever needs to come out. It's so important to just let it out and let it out in a safe way. In an environment where you're fully accepting it versus in these perverse ways in your procrastination or continuing to choose like a toxic situationship or whatever, but like letting it out now and just bringing acceptance and love and playfulness to it. Like, I just love feeling this like sexy grr, like, and noticing the power that comes with that, the power that your shadow side has, and how powerful would it be instead of dividing and conquering these different parts of yourself? How powerful would it be if you told your shadow side, join me, let's amplify the power that is me by combining my darkness and light. And that's also why when I close out my yoga classes, which I'll do at the end of Powerful Stuff today too, but I always say like the light and the darkness in me recognizes the light and the darkness in you, not just the light in you, but I recognize and I see and I love all sides of you is what I say. And hopefully you feel that way too. So go ahead and find that like sexy, ragey song. Let your shadow side speak, let it out, let out some primal sounds. And then when you're done, place your hand on your heart and your hand on your stomach. And if you haven't danced yet, that's okay. You can do it after the recording. We'll do a little meditation around it now. So just feeling your hand on your heart, one hand on your stomach, bringing your shadow side to the surface, like you're pulling them out to the surface and just telling them first and foremost that you love them. Just noticing how they look, finally coming to the light, their energy, their expression. And regardless of how they look, replacing your judgment with compassion and just telling them, you know what? I love you. I love you just as you are. I love you for all that you've already done in the past. I love you unconditionally. And as you see your shadow side start to soften, go ahead and ask your shadow side, like, what about these things or what about your current situation? Are they trying to control? Why are they trying to control it? What do they like about the situation? Trusting whatever answer they say. Even if it's surprising or feels random. And just asking your shadow side, what are they afraid of? What are they afraid of if you step into this thing that you say you really want? Are they afraid of being seen? Are they afraid of losing something? Are they afraid of a belief shattering? Letting them answer just curiosity and compassion. And then asking them what they need from you to trust you, that you'll love them no matter what, and that they're safe to expand with you into this new unfamiliar area. What does your shadow side need from you? What reassurance or acknowledgement do they need? Letting them know that you can give that, and then bringing them in for a hug, and as you hug them, feeling them breathe into your heart, you breathing into theirs, forming this beautiful, cohesive, harmonious, holistic swirl from the base of your hips, like dark and light, swirling up together, swirling up through your navel center, connecting you to all sides of your power, swirling up your heart, connecting you even deeper to them and thus even deeper to all sides of others, swirling up your throat, connecting you to your voice in all areas, being able to express your vulnerability powerfully, swirling up to touch your intuition so you can distinguish when you're afraid and tap into what your shadow side needs, and then swirling up and out the crown of your head, this beautiful light and dark together, harmoniously connecting you to the pulse of the rest of the universe. Taking a deep breath in and exhale to open your eyes, coming back into this space. Wow. How do you feel? Just giving your shadow side that love and acceptance that it's yearning for. And go ahead and take a few minutes to write down what came up. Writing a letter to yourself, actually, from your shadow side of just why it's scared or why it's been acting up and what it needs. So pausing the recording and like you are your shadow side, because you are, writing to your current self or your conscious self from your shadow side's perspective. Taking a few minutes to do that, pausing it. And then when you unpause, I want you to write a response to your shadow side of like, I get it. It is scary. Or I know that you enjoy like that narrative because like that identity was part of you. Maybe it's like that narrative of like, oh, I always choose these guys and they're always assholes, but that's how I like bond with other people. And that helps me stay in I am not enough, or I have a fear of intimacy and I'm afraid that if I choose people that I could actually really fall for, then I'll really get hurt. Whatever it might be, just acknowledging them, letting them know that you've got them and you're in it together. Wow, isn't it amazing what we can do when we have that dialogue with ourselves, guys? And one of the funny examples, I know I recommended it at the beginning of the episode, I'm going to recommend it again here, cannot recommend enough, Carolyn Elliott. One day she's going to be on the pod, mark my words, we're going to talk about existential kink together. Watch this space, Carolyn, if you're listening, I fucking love you. You've changed my world. But yeah, one of the examples she gives is like somebody, or this idea, like somebody always like attracting kind of like scarcity around money and their car breaking down and constantly needing help and then still living in their parents' house. And the existential kink thing she came to with it, and this is just giving you an example to like further hopefully assist your unlocks as you're going through this with your shadow side, is that in that particular case, that person realized they liked being taken care of. They enjoyed being taken care of, and they were like, that subconscious part of them was afraid, like, will I be able to take care of myself if I move out of my parents' house, if everything's abundant? And then what if I have to take care of other people? So it's like, oh, okay. So it was a fear of like, or a craving of being taken care of. So that's why I'm creating those situations. So if we realize that, for example, then what are the ways you can start to show yourself to take care of yourself in these smaller ways? So you can build that trust, you know? So that's just an example. And the existential kink example I'll give, I should have given this at the top, but I'll give it now, that changed my life was when I first read the book, I had this toxic dating pattern of always choosing emotionally unavailable men. And it was a game of cat and mouse. And I would spend so much time analyzing like every single text message that they sent. I would analyze it with my friends. It would take up a whole lot of time. I would do that instead of like my creative projects, and I'd let it drain me from my power. So when I read Existential Kink, I realized like part of me liked feeling powerless, you know, liked feeling not enough, because that helped reinforce my belief. So when I did Existential Kink, and she invites you to have a playful tone with it, I was just like, some part of me just loves giving away my power to emotionally unavailable men. I love feeling powerless, because then it distracts me from my actual goals of feeling seen in my creativity. And so I just give my power away and it feels so good. And these guys don't even know that they have it. They don't even know the power that I'm giving them. So it's just like having that little playful tone with it, which is really fun once you get into it. But doing existential kink actually helped me break that toxic pattern, which introduced me to my now husband, Spencer. And when I was aware of that pattern, I noticed when it was coming up again. And again, I would give my deepest fear, like, what do you need? Why are you scared? And it allowed me to sit through some situations with my husband in the early days of dating, where, you know, I wanted us to be together and he was on his motorcycle journey from Canada to Argentina. And, he didn't think he would be dating someone long distance. And when we were falling in love, but having these conversations, it allowed me to not like force an ultimatum. It allowed me to not be like, it's all or nothing or like, fuck you, you know, cause I did the deepest fear inventory. My deepest fear is he doesn't choose me. My deepest fear is he walks away. My deepest fear is he falls in love with someone else on his journey. And I meant nothing to him. And I allowed myself to go there. I allowed myself to feel those deepest fears internally, that when I had the conversation with him, I was centered and I wasn't creating those fears in a subverse way or self-fulfilling prophecy, because I had already allowed myself to experience them on my own. I was able to sit in my queen energy with him and be like, I'm not going to sit here and ask you to choose me. If freedom for you means being able to go on the road and experience other people intimately, that's your choice. For me, like, what I need to feel safe is to like be committed to somebody. And that helps me feel even more free. And if that's you, great. And if your choice is something else, totally cool. I'm not going to sit here and ask you to choose me. By me not putting pressure on him and being able to stay in curiosity as he answered, it allowed him the space to come to the conclusion of wanting to be with me on his own rather than feeling pressured. So that's just existential kink in the wild for you guys. I have one last little fun exercise that we can do together, which is, and I do it with all my upgrade ladies at the end of our session. It's, I want you to write like you're writing a reality TV show description for your shadow side of like somebody on like one of those trashy dating shows. And like really play up the drama. And I want you to pause the recording and write it out. And I'll give you my example of mine first, based on the shadow work that I'm doing right now with like the procrastination and stuff. This is Meredith. She just loves saying that she's going to do this big thing. And then she loves getting angry at all the other people who are doing it instead by sitting on her phone and scrolling and just sitting in her resentment of how she could have done it better and how she has all this more experience, but then she'll just sit and scroll and get more angry and more angry. And instead of actually doing it, she just loves sitting there in her regret. It thrills her. It turns her on. Okay. That one was a little rough around the edges, guys, but you get the point. So pause recording. And then I want you to read it back to me and read it in that like sassy voice. Just like owning your shadow side. Like, this is my shadow side. Kind of like that crazy friend we all have. This is my crazy friend. She's so crazy, but I love her. So just go ahead and read it. Wow. So sassy. I freaking love that. And how I describe it too with like, that's our crazy friend. Just to further the analogy, guys, is like, imagine that, you know, you have that crazy friend who, let's say, like went out and get really drunk and does something embarrassing because she just did, but you love her. You know, you're not going to be at the club or the bar and be like, oh my gosh, I don't know who she is, or like, I disown her. Like, fuck that girl. Like, chances are, if she's your crazy friend, but you love her, you kindly escort her home, you tuck her in bed, you get her some electrolyte water, and the next day you're like, yeah, there were some funny moments there. What did you learn? You know, and you're there for her and you're not shaming her and she feels better because you were in her presence. So that's the same idea with our shadow side, guys. So the last thing to end this episode, well, a few things. Number one, Carolyn Elliott has an amazing existential kink meditation that you should try. If you go to her website, you can probably find it, or DM me if you can't and I'll help you out. I also have a shadow side breath work. If you want it, DM me, I'll send it to you. And there's another person in the shadow work realm called Byron Katie, who has this thing called The Work, literally The Work. And she has on her website, like Byron Katie's The Work, if you Google it, Judge Your Neighbor worksheet. And usually our shadow side can also come out when we're feeling like triggered by a coworker or triggered by someone or in comparison, or we're like, why does this friend always do this? They're annoying me. And you fill out the worksheet about all of the things that they're doing that are so annoying to you. And then you actually, like, you read the worksheet out loud with their name in it. Like, I'm annoyed at so-and-so for not acknowledging me. And then you replace their name with yours. And it's like, I'm annoyed at Meredith for not acknowledging me. And it's like, whoa, mind blown. And the reason for that is, like, in that situation, it's like, by spending all that time being annoyed that my friend isn't acknowledging me, I'm using that time acknowledging her in that way versus giving myself the acknowledgement that I need. So it's like redirecting my power. And shadow side can be a hefty concept, guys. But the whole idea too is that if we can radically own that we've created some part of the situation that we've chosen to, or that we've continued to allow to happen to us, then we can radically create where we go next. So the radical ownership and radical responsibility is actually very empowering, because then it allows us to say, okay, some part of me radically created this, so now I can radically get out of that. Isn't that wonderful? Wow. I hope this powerful stuff episode, as always, was as powerful for you guys as it was for me. And my one last little assignment for you, read Existential Kink, do the shadow dance, and then I want you to take yourself on a shadow date this week. And what I mean by that is, like, let your shadow indulge for 1 hour of, like, fully condoned acceptance of shadow work. Or 1 hour, it can be even 30 minutes or 10 minutes. Like, and it's like that idea of just like, okay, you say you want to do this, then let's fucking do this. Like, you know, for instance, if you're like, I like love snapping at my partner just because I like need to cause a fight or whatever. It's like, maybe your shadow date is going to a rage room and just like getting all your rage out and breaking shit. Rage rooms do exist. You should look them up. They're awesome. For another example, like if mine was, you know, the scrolling because I want to play small, it's like, okay, I'm going to have 10 minutes where I'm just going to scroll and I'm going to look at all the people that trigger me. And then I'm going to be like, Meredith, don't you feel like shit? Don't you just love looking at all of these people that are doing these things that you're not doing? But just that idea of like consciousness of like, this is what my shadow side is doing. This is its indulgence. I've given it its indulgence. Now we can move on. So let me know what your shadow date is this week. We'll close out with our three breaths. And then we'll go on with our life in full harmony, shadow and light, powerful. So taking a deep breath in, breathing in your shadow side, letting your shadow side know you love it. Exhale, releasing it, bringing acceptance to it. Another breath in, breathing in your light side, like your highest self energy. Exhaling that out. Knowing that that's always present in you. Breathing in your shadow side and your light side, both of them actually making your most powerful self when you know how to speak to both, how to harness both. Honoring both sides of you as you exhale that out, feeling full acceptance and love for all sides of you, which thus allows you to have even more empathy and compassion for all sides of others. Isn't that wonderful? Okay, guys, the light and the darkness sees and honors. The light and the darkness in me sees and honors the light and the darkness in you. And I will see you next week for more powerful stuff.